So, welcome to the first afternoon track. I will start with a little bit of an overview and outlook regarding ODF for ODF State of the Union. So what happened in the past, what's the plan, what's in store for the next year. So that's me. Been doing open office work and LibreOffice work for a number of years. And been involved with TF doing this initial work. Happily working for CIB. I was paying my salary, the travel here, and I was sponsoring the conference. Okay, right, so just a reminder, that's the year we're in, 2018, but we're still at ODF 1 or 2. So, it's been for, who knows when was the last, when was ODF 1 or 2 ratified, standardized by ways? Anybody else? Almost 8 years ago. So, time to wake up. You know, first off, some history. As I say, 2011 was the ODF 1 or 2. So it started with the Star Office XML format. So at some stage, some decided that XML would be a much better document format than anybody else was doing binary document formats before, at least in the office landscape. So some was at the Star Office Open Office team back in the day were the first to came up with that idea. And they just wrote a filter for the Star Office formats. And then somebody at some said, actually why not standardize that? Wouldn't it be a great idea, since for XML you can write a schema and you can validate, and you can tell other people how to read that, and it's nicely documented, it's not only great for the world at large, but it's also great for the open project, like OpenOffice, it's nicely documented. So that's when it started. There was an inaugural meeting in 2002. Rather quickly, only have one or two then out of the door in 2005, and a rather quick succession, roughly every two and a half years, there was an update to ODF. That suddenly stopped for good reasons in 2011. It's been languishing since then, and the problem with that. It's that it's not that the development work has stopped. So there are still features being added, there are still problems being found in the old specification. So at some stage, it will be quite helpful to roll all of this to a new standard. Right. So. That's what happened, so it's not that nothing happened, actually quite a bit happened, just that no new. So the ultimate goal of the standardization committee, of course, is to rule new standards, and that's the problem that didn't happen. So there was three concepts, so first of all, this advanced movement, but this, what was the task of this advanced document collaboration subcommittee? You're not expected to answer.
Sorry.
So the task there was that, the change tracking markup in ODF is a bit underspecified and it's not complete. So this is quite an important part of especially text, for text document interoperability. learn through a total of 3 concepts, bring lots of goodwill, lots of energy, lots of time, and produce lots of minutes. And there's no update yet, but there's at least the last one for 3 concepts is still in the works now. And it's currently having a break, I think, until later this year due to people. And that's really the core of the issue, that with the, so that there's no accident that work, especially for writings that are essentially stopped in 2011, because that coincides with the pretty much the end of open office and also the exit of the larger corporate sponsors of that project, and some standardization work, especially writing standard and shepherding through all the bureaucracy, is pretty tiring, time consuming, and something that volunteers usually do. You usually need someone to be paid for that, which is usually pretty expensive, so that just stopped from happening. Right. 1.3, that's the supposed to be next standard. There was some discussion of call it 1.3 or 2.0, since very likely this strange tracking thing won't make it for 1.3 or for the next version. People decided to call the next version 1.3 because it's an iteration, kind of a minor update, iteration of a major update. And so far there's been more than 350 issues worked on, and get the provisional target of 1.3. So that's quite a chunk of backlog. I'm reasonably certain that at least ODF 1.1 is much, much less in scope. I also think 1.2 is a bit less. There's also a lot of debugging that was going on with the standard. Lots of problems found, lots of underspecified or unclear wording of the standard found, some latent mistakes, some errors that were just forgotten, so that were not specified at all. yes, and that was, most of that was due to a massive backlog of improvements, especially in the LibreOffice. That then all went, since we wanted to write at least this standard conformance level, it was then put into some separate namespace. So when you look at an ODF document, usually most of what's in there is in the office, in the ODF office namespace. But I mean, Oasis is permitted to put new things there, or to change existing things whenever you extend the file form, because you need to somehow store a new feature, you put it into a separate namespace, it's called extension namespace, and you document it on your product page that you have extended ODF in such a way, and then you explain what you did there, and what's the feature, and what's the markup. And of course, every vendor, every project is then strongly encouraged to feed that back into the FTC, so that eventually it becomes a standard. Sometimes that just means finding the change in the markup and to propose some text, some prose for the written standard. Sometimes that involves some larger discussions, so other vendors would say, okay, we have something similar, so that we can merge that into some larger feature. Or someone puts a hole into that and says, well, this is a really stupid idea, there's a markup already, why not use that? So usually there's some discussion going on when the new solution comes in. At the end, though, it benefits all of us, I think, if new features get standardized so that the true value of ODF, which is a standardized format that all people agree on, is maintained. So if every vendor or every project does their own extensions at some stage, the amount of changes that people cannot really interact with is so large that it becomes like unusable. And last but not least, maintenance work on and around existing version server. busy work that TC is doing. Great, so that was what actually happened. Why I'm here is also partially because since quite a while nothing really substantial happened in terms of what matters, which is getting the standard out. So there was some concrete action finally. I'd really like to highlight one name here, which is Regina Henschel, who is for TDF, for the Document Foundation, part of the ODFTC, so she's a purely volunteer, she's a teacher in real life, but she comes every week and attends the ODFTC calls and does great work there, finds bugs in the existing standard and proposes new things. Also finds lots of bugs in LibreOffice, where LibreOffice is not standard compliant, and either fixes LibreOffice or proposes to change the standards, but if nobody else is implementing that, then the standard matches what LibreOffice is doing. And she approached the Document Foundation with the proposal to, if it could perhaps be possible, to fund somebody to write the, or to edit the new ODF version. And TDF thought that's a brilliant idea, and after lots of deliberation and lots of back and forth, and lots of looking in the pockets for some money of the TDF, we finally this year got some seed funding up. And so the plan was to just have some kickstart, like some 10k or something euro, just to get it off the launch pad, plus some matching funds, so that for every other company that would chip in funds, TDF would match that funding up to a certain limit, and that rent. Didn't go badly, so it actually went as well as Microsoft stepped up to the plate and said, yes, we will fund that or co-fund that. All of this is running with public software, CIC. It's a charity in the UK founded by Simon and I think Andrew Clark's sister is his partner there. And so essentially TDF said, okay, here's the money, we'll find the companies who fund that, and then find some editor and contract that out. And all of that happened, so Francis Cave is tasked to edit a new ODF version. Francis is the SC34 chair, which is on the ISO level. Group that is then receiving the OASIS TC, so the OASIS standard, and then moves that to ISO standard level, which is an internationally recognized. So Francis Cave is the chairperson who then will eventually receive what he seems like writing. So I think that's a pretty good idea to, and he's a very experienced standard professional. And he's partnering with Patrick Russo, who's the current chair of the OEFTC. And they're both working, as we speak, working on the very first updated draft for 1.3. So the all kind of, so initially, Regina really kicked us all into action. So there was some grumbling, and some people were broadly in agreement, in violent agreement, that this is not a sustainable situation. And she kicked us into action and ultimately managed to get the ball rolling again, including the TC freezing 1.3 submissions in June as the first step. So you say, well, this is the deadline. Every issue, everything that you do after that date will not be considered for 1.3. Anymore, so that after that the editors can start working on the standard without constantly having to update and change things. And it was also quite helpful because it was really focusing people on, oh, this 3-year-old issue, I should probably look into that and finish the final there's anybody here in this room who is using, working for a corporation that is using ODF or that is selling products based on ODF, please do consider funding. So there's still a bit of budget left from this matching budget at TDF. It would be a shame to let that lapse. So if you are, even if it's a small amount, please do step up to the plate, talk to me or talk to Simon Phipps, and we will work out how to do that. We have funding secured, but we are at least able to push that towards the end of the year, hopefully with the first committee draft, but we have not secured funding beyond that. So, heralding that then through the standardization process and bureaucracy, and perhaps editing further, accepting comments, that is not secured yet. So please, or ask friends and family, or if you have other companies in mind, please do approach them. I think it's important to know. And it can be that it's just Microsoft. Okay, second thing that's going to happen, Italo mentioned that already, so the ODF marketing is also kind of took a dip and was launching dormant, and there's some work underway to reinvigorate the adoption TC in some form. Whether that's exactly that committee or something else, I think it's still open to debate. The goal of it for that is to coordinate marketing around ODF ramping up, like when sometime next year or three hopefully will be approved to have marketing in place to really get the word out for that. So a quick walkthrough development sites, what could happen there. There's also a very nice initiative I'd like to highlight. Noki, I think, who was in the room, but it's not anymore. So he started quite a number of years ago, and said it's really not a good idea that for something like LibreOffice, where lots and lots and lots of changes come in every day, that that ODF compliance can break at any time. So that's a patch, and somebody commits that, and it's another patch, and a succession of four patches all together lead to the problem that suddenly LibreOffice writes in that ODF. And that only then gets called like a year later when the version is shipped and somebody is running through a validator. And that's really not how it should be. So what you really need for development at the scale that LibreOffice is developed is about immediate feedback. So ideally you want a test to break so that it doesn't even leave your disk, or if it does leave your disk and it goes to Garrett, the code review system, then at least the continuous integration should fail there at latest. So he started to set up some things, running some ODF validator on the results, on the written output for some unit tests. The EC really liked that idea, and so tender that CIB, my company, then started implementing in late 2016. And that the goals for that is that validation is the default. So anything that entry tests, entry code is writing in the LibreOffice build environment is tested for validity. Most importantly, of course, for ODF, but also for, you can do the same for OXML and even for Microsoft Line performance. This talk focuses on ODF, but just so you know that we have a similar plumbing in place for OXML for the Line performance. It's a bit more involved, so for Linux, you need some Line emulator for that to run. OXML is using a plain XML validator to keep updated versions of the schema and the tree. So whatever you do there with attached file format, you add a new feature, then you need to adjust relax and leave schema. And with that part of the patch, you can just directly go to the TC and say, okay, I'd like to propose the following new markup in the schema. And that's indeed how it works. So you just check it out on the auto journey mag, either it works or it breaks, nothing else you need to do. It also runs on the crash testing machine, which is a much larger scope of documents, a much larger pile of documents that's run through. So it's running once a week. And it gets a reporting done to the mailing list, so whoever is developing LibreOffice will get the weekly crash test updates. And that has a column for validity problems in XML forms, including ODF. That is not down to zero, so there's ongoing work there. That's also not something that breaks the build. But it potentially breaks the build if somebody adds a unit test that touches a feature that was not yet written anywhere, but it's been used by one of the web docs that are run on the crash testing machine, then you will suddenly see that. So that's one of the very obvious easy hacks. It's potentially also something like a GSOC project or GCI project to go through all of invalidity errors in the crash testing machine. Okay, so that's almost all I wanted to say. Just a quick outlook, take them all with a grain of salt.
So 5 minutes.
Take that with a grain of salt. This is this June 2018, obviously that date has passed, so you can take that for granted. Everything else, that's how we plan to do that. Whether that works out in standardization, that is even less certain than in software development. Always that's the idea. So before 6.2, which is due in February, the plan is towards the end of the year to have the first committee draft. Specification. It doesn't necessarily mean it's the last one, but that should be the first cut at a new product here. Then we get lots of reviews, many more people looking into that, whether we've got something. As I mentioned, something that does some marketing around ODF running up and running until then, and hopefully have something standardized by Oasis next year. So that in theory you can be much faster as a 30-day minimum review and voting period for new standards, but whenever somebody finds a problem, that sends you back at the drawing board so that it's easy. It's like 3 times, 4 times that when you need to fix things. So but hopefully until 6.3 we have something out. And meanwhile the TC proceed, like the people like Regina and Martha Schaar and Patrick and Andreas moved on and are now working on ODF Next, which is probably either 1.4 or 2.0, depending on how things are going. That's far out. Still leaves the problem how to possibly fund editing work for that. So we will probably have to meet each other next year. And I will ask you again if you know someone who would be willing to fund or help funding an ODF editor. But I think the form is important enough, and the idea behind the truly open standard is important enough that my hope is that we will find. Collectively find enough funding to keep that going. And simply because it would be sharing the number of fronts, not limited to the fact that so much volunteer work goes into actual GC work. But all the stuff that has been happening in the past seven, eight years would have been for naught, would be wasted. There's no standards, all those more than 350 issues, many hours of standardization calls and work on that. It's like writing software but not releasing it. So it's quite wasteful. So the hope is that with this successfully running, we have many more of those funding rounds and keep going pretty much well. Thanks for your attention, and I think we have some one or two left questions. Thank you. Regarding LibreOffice, so let me try to repeat. So there's two questions. First is about ODF 1.3 support for LibreOffice, and then there's about whether ODF support in general for Microsoft Office. I can't answer the last question. It's also perhaps a strategy or product management question now for LibreOffice that. Depending on how things are going, I would at least not rule out that from the development side we might want to start writing out the new 1.3 once the first committee draft is out. So possibly with the work starting for 6.3, so the launch of the 6.3 is somewhere in November. So starting December or January next year, we could in theory start with changing all the LOX namespaces to proper office namespaces. But that's quite some work though, because you also need, you can't just say, okay, I'm just writing out the new stuff, and when somebody with an old document comes, then we can't read it anymore. So you still need some mapping from the old extension namespaces to the new ones. So there is some work to do, but it's pretty. So that's easy to crowdsource. So that's you do that once for one of the changes. And it's reasonably easy to do that as an easy hack for 200 more. So, but it's still working. Do you have another question?
Yeah.
Do you have any idea of the proportion of the extended things that LibreOffice does today to 1.2? How much of those are going to 1.3? So you just can remove them from 1.2 extended?
I don't have that situation
where you always
check.
More of a feeling.
So the thing is that you can check that. You check out the Git repository, you look into the schema subdirectory, and there's a LibreOffice 1.3 schema subdirectory, and you just diff that with the proper 1.2, and that's the number of changes that we have. So that's one of the nice features of this validation framework that you have some 99% of the LibreOffice is writing today, and ODF, it's already there in the schemas, we can just see what's the difference.